One might ask, how does it feel after having blown the whistle, cracked the cosmic conspiracy, blown the whistle on the great cosmic conspiracy? Very stressful. Severe fatigue, but bouncing back today with some humor. Of course, it's very shocking. When you see how we keep ourselves bound to delusion on a cosmic scale, actually, then it's very sobering, and it does bring some shock to speak up on this, because it's such an intense issue that affects all spirit that is engaged in this ridiculous attempt to disempower itself. Essentially, what we're doing is we're saying that we must disempower God, and if we don't disempower God, if we fail to disempower God, God will be disempowered. If you boil it all down, the whole cosmic dream, which is really an attempt to attack God, the entire cosmic dream, if you boil it all down, it says, we are essentially saying, if we don't find a way to disempower God, then God is going to be disempowered. Okay? This is at its very root essence. Okay, if you can just look at it like that, then it might lighten your day a little bit. Because boil everything down, all right? Just one, the root of what our position is, this is it. We are saying, we are feeling, we are believing, if we do not find a way to disempower God, then God is going to be disempowered. And it's a very tricky thing too, isn't it? Because if you say, okay, let's stop trying to disempower God, and that's ridiculous, then we'll say, well, wait a minute. If we stop working to disempower God, then God's going to be disempowered. We can't stop. We have to keep trying. We have to keep trying to keep God from being disempowered. What a great tricky motivation to keep us slaving away on trying to accomplish the impossible, right? So as always, we recognize we have a very severe continuity problem. In fact, that is the only problem in the cosmos. The entire cosmos is a continuity problem. And this manifests as a lack of familiarity. One of the ways is a lack of familiarity with truth, with the speaking of truth. For instance, what we just said, our basic premise is if we don't find a way to disempower God, God will be disempowered. And of course, we are God. We are the extension of God. God is all, so we are God. So we're saying if we don't disempower ourselves, we're going to be disempowered. And we're not familiar with this talk. We're not familiar with spiritual talk at all. Real spiritual talk. So this lack of familiarity permeates the cosmos, and it prevents spirit from recognizing the absurdity at the root of all this nonsense. And this is the trouble. And so lack of familiarity throws up a wall. So if you start talking to people, if you try to... what I found is that if you try to get serious and start introducing familiarity with spiritual teachings, it gets real serious, and then what happens is the continuity problem that people have, the lack of familiarity, what they do is they immediately collapse into like this fetal mental position of talking points, right? And then it becomes their talking points against your talking points, because there's no longer any, you know, hearing at all. It's just talking points back and forth. And so they're saying, you yield to my talking points. So at that level, you have to say, well, no, you have to yield to my talking points, because lies must yield to truth. Okay, truth doesn't yield to lies. So when you're bringing up and focusing on truth, those talking points are the correct talking points if you're going to use talking points. So they immediately switch to talking points. And that's it. So it has to be talking points. Just you see that in the politics, right? The political circus that goes on is everybody is just using talking points. Kind, compassionate, considerate. Let's just, you know, let's see what truth has to say about this. Let's see if we can get to the truth. Maybe we can just drop this whole thing. Maybe truth is not interested in this. That's the casualty of the modern age. And we have just these talking points going back and forth. So, lack of familiarity causes a lapse into talking points by the one who is afraid of, you know, not familiar with listening to truth. This is a global problem. This is a cosmic problem. I've been able to shift my clarity into a cosmic context now. It's the only really problem there is, because once we gain familiarity, real familiarity, then momentum can come into the picture, and more clarification comes, and then success is inevitable. So what is the remedy? What is the RX? The remedy. Clarity Ross is RX for the cosmic problem, cosmic continuity problem, and that would be a monastic culture, a religious church or temple or whatever you want to call it, place of worship culture, a place of worship culture, a monastic culture, a basic theocratic culture. And so why does this help out? It helps out because when we're in culture in this world, we don't realize that we're taking everything in by osmosis. Even if we're not aware of it, it's getting into us by cultural osmosis. And so if we live in this secular materialistic culture, which we do now, most of us, that all gets into us severely. And that breeds a contempt and a disinterest and a shift of our attention away from the talking points of truth that we need to listen to. And so it builds up unfamiliarity, builds up the continuity problem for us. So living in a theocratic place of worship, monastic culture, religious culture, what happens is, just living in that culture, you take in so much by osmosis, you take in so much, and you just begin to get a general comfort zone. Okay, general comfort zone with spiritual topics, deep spiritual topics. And then this is greatly beneficial for you. Greatly beneficial. One of the great theocratic, monastic place of worship, religious cultures was, for instance, Tibet throughout the ages. And they had spectacular success in many, many instances of realization, actually. You're born into this and you pick it all up. I mean, the kids, you know, just osmosis, it gets into them. And so there's great familiarity. They don't, you know, just like we're familiar with going to the mall, you know, they're familiar with meditation. And so this is actually the remedy for everyone. This is the great prescription, Clarity Ross is RX for cosmic continuity problem. Shift of cultural context, most definitely. There's no way, okay, there is no way for someone to come riding in on a white horse and say, everybody, I know what's wrong with existence, this is what it is, you are, your basic conundrum is you're saying, I need to disempower God, and if I don't, God will be disempowered. And it's a complete absurdity. Drop it. There is no time, space, process, or form determinism whatsoever. You're perfectly free. Nothing ever happened. That's it. And everybody goes, oh, we were just waiting for you to tell us. Someone to come along and tell us. Okay, we get it. Done deal. Drop it. Okay. This is the fantasy that our delusion perpetuates, is the idea of a savior coming riding in on a white horse. That's never going to happen. All right, it doesn't happen. If it did, it would already happen, you know, long ago and many times, you know. We've had perfect teachers come into this world. It didn't happen at all. So that is never going to happen because of the continuity problem, because of the familiarity problem. You cannot. It'll put people into complete shock and they'll develop severe defensive feelings, feelings of being attacked and fear, and gang up and try to get rid of this, you know, and say it's a liar, it's deceit, and all this stuff. It doesn't work. So what works is this gradual osmosis of getting familiar, more and more familiar, more and more familiar. And the familiarity is the key, because then it's you're comfortable, you're in a comfort zone. It's very easy to start looking at stuff in your mind, these concepts, look at this, how's this, you know, and start differentiating between dualism and non-dualism, which ultimately one has to be able to differentiate. You read the books, you know, your whole culture is with prayer, reading books, study, and talk, conversation around the table is on spiritual themes, etc. I tried to bring that into the world, this life, and just got crushed, absolutely crushed. People refuse to do it. So it's a non-starter. This culture is a complete non-starter. Again, the lie that we're told is that that don't worry, some savior will come along and we'll be all swept up into sanity instantly. Continuity problem of familiarity blocks that. It's a pragmatic block, severe block. So you have to work at it bit by bit by bit, gradually. Continue to foster familiarity. The more you foster familiarity, the easier it gets. And then you can even crack the whole cosmic conspiracy, which has certainly swept up this planet in its net. And you won't be overly bothered by it and say, wow, that's pretty cool. Alright, but you just keep on keeping on. And you'll also be able to truly differentiate between dualistic delusion and non-dual truth, non-dual abidance. And you will be liberated, you will be free from the desire for liberation, you'll be free from the desire to defeat anything, to get free of anything. You'll be free from the desire to be free, which is interfering with your acceptance and awareness of the freedom that you already are. That's what's interfering. The crusade is what distracts you from the realization you already have everything you want. Okay? The crusade is the distractor from realizing you're already perfect. You already have everything you want. Everyone does. Can't ever be otherwise. So whatever, doesn't matter how positive the crusade is. Now, from a pragmatic standpoint, from a continuity fear pragmatic standpoint, because we have this severe continuity problem, we need a culture. And because it's so difficult to approach it directly, it's very difficult to approach it directly. That's what I had to do. And I wouldn't recommend that path for anyone. That is for sure. It's too difficult. Where there's not a supportive culture, where you just have to do it directly by yourself, just directly, it's ridiculously difficult. So it's doable, but I don't recommend it. And what I recommend is, again, in a culture that through osmosis, a lot of stuff just you end up developing this overall comfort zone, which can then be used to help you move more easily and get deeper and deeper familiarity with clearer and greater clarity. That is what can really be beneficial to everyone that lives in such a culture. At least theoretically. I don't know pragmatically exactly how it works out. But it's very evident that those who try to abide in some sort of culture like that, a religious place of worship, monastic, theocratic culture, don't seem to be as easily fooled by the cosmic conspiracy, the cosmic crusaders that have come to this world. They're not as easily fooled at all. They just say, no, this isn't it. This isn't it. So that's very positive. It shows up. It definitely shows. But truly, we have to do, there has to be a much better job at this. maybe not even on this planet, maybe some other planets and places. Because this one here is going in the wrong direction, for sure. Even though it believes it's going in the right direction, right? That's part of the backwardness that we have here. Very backward place. So I would say the role, the way I see my role is participating, helping out those who are helping foster this theocratic, religious, monastic place of worship, culture, fostering that on different planets, different places in the cosmos, wherever it may be, so that people, so the spirits will have a chance. You know, with this familiar, with this continuity issue, it's like they feel like they don't even have a chance. Don't even have a chance. And I've tested this out in this world my whole life, tested it out. Nobody, you can't just, the problem with this, the culture is so sabotaging of this, that you can talk to somebody for 20 years and it's in one ear and out the other. It doesn't get you anywhere because they're not capable. They're too frightened because the culture doesn't support it. So it takes someone who's really, self-contained and doesn't really care about what society and culture thinks about them so much. They're not, just whatever, doesn't matter. It takes someone who's willing to just, go ahead no matter what anybody says in order to get it done in this sort of situation, which is what I was like. I tended to just... said, well, I'm going to do it anyway. I don't care what anyone says. But the pressure was terrible, 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 terrible. And, not many have built up that sort of feeling like they don't really have to answer or succumb to world pressure, etc., like that. So you can't pull yourself up by the bootstraps. You cannot. It just can't be done. I've tried it. I've just tried to help people out. No, it doesn't work. So they need a monastic religious culture. They need it. It's needed. So they can look around and say, wow, okay, everybody who supports, if I start thinking this way, talking this way, acting this way, everyone's going to say, yeah, this is the right thing to do. We support that. And they go, oh, great. But with the economic competition that we have on this planet, what's driving everybody is the corporate, mantra of productivity. And you cannot make it under those circumstances. It's I've only gotten this far due to exceptionally unusual circumstances. But if you're out there, just trying to your very best to get ahead and get a leg up, and competing and working intensely and trying to meet the quotas and trying to stay, keep your job and everything, and that's there's no reinforcement whatsoever of your beliefs, etc. That's like trying to grow a garden in a desert where there's no water. So, I don't see, the way it's going, I don't see a large-scale revival. The notion that we're all going to be enlightened, I think, is absolutely ridiculous. I think what's going to happen in this time frame we're in is the false enlightenment, the false awakening. As I pointed out, that's the cosmic conspiracy. So everybody will think that they've got it. And there's no greater defense against truth than to think you already have it. Because, everyone's woken up. We now know what we need to defeat. We know what we're up against. We know, what we need to defeat. God. gotta get rid of the darkness. Who are the bad ones? We figured out what's bad now, finally. We know how to please God by getting rid of what's bad. Until they'll have this, you know, fake enlightenment, planetary enlightenment. And then that, because you have this sense of this planetary righteousness based on false premise, based on a, really, what they really say is, we finally know how to disempower ourselves now. Great, so God won't be disempowered. The only problem with that is we are God. So if we're found a way to disempower ourselves, we found a way to disempower God, and we would disempower ourselves, which actually is impossible. So on goes the dream, on goes the dream like that. So what I've done in my life is I've tried to foster familiarity, always talking about spiritual, you know, topics. It's like pouring water into a desert, and it just sinks into the sand here. People, by and large, are just oblivious to it. Oblivious to it, are very defended in various ways. You know, they're just because there's not a culture that supports it, and that tends to make us a bit brittle and worried, etc., like that. The comfort zone, the wide comfort zone, the wide safety net, isn't there. You compare this time to previous times of different places in the world, it's just unbelievable how different it is. We are straitjacketed here in this world now to an extraordinary extent. And you look at these various cities around the world, and you see the hustle and the bustle, and you realize it's the business of this planet is business, and you're not going to make it that way. You're simply not going to make it. So there has to be a different approach taken. What's been pointed out abundantly in these videos is the trending of this world, and I'm now seeing, you know, it is a cosmic conspiracy to take over this planet and turn this planet into a planet of sheeple, where they have no familiarity with what they need to be familiar with in order to realize, get free of this delusion of determinism, this delusion that there's some universe. So there's fostering no familiarity. And I found that those who are not familiar, automatically they defend against this by sabotaging it, constantly trying to sabotage it. This has been my experience here. It's not like they're open mind. Okay, well, sure, I have an open mind. No, their mind is closed, but in order to keep a closed mind, you have to fend off truth, because truth is within us, actually. We have to fend it off somehow. So we're always sabotaging in very clever ways. Very clever ways. And when we feel this, we're losing the battle, we jump into talking points of delusion, all the talking points. You know, and it's almost like we become robotic, and we're just spouting out talking points. Defensive, protective. We jump into our little shell. And it gets nowhere. So it's a waste of time. It's essentially a waste of time. So it may be that engaging with this planet is a complete waste of time. Because what needs to be done is preparing some monastic culture, get ready for that. And especially the children need to be raised in a monastic style, so they are trained from the get-go in meditation, in contemplation, in using their will, the right use of will, the right use of exercise and movement or movement and music, how to give others their quietness too, the right use in turning the other cheek, don't get into arguments, stay the right use of centering, how to stay centered. All of this teaching, spiritual teachings, can begin when the children are young, and they can be educated in that. And along with the books, what they're reading, the familiarity can be utilized so that they feel comfortable with then going on and working more intensely, like phase 2, 3, and 4. So to reiterate, we have this sort of prevailing idea that don't worry, the Savior on the white horse will arrive, and we'll all immediately say, oh yeah, now we get it now. With no preparation, with constant habits of sabotage in our thinking, our beliefs being structured to sabotage truth, everything we're familiar with being used to sabotage truth, and to sabotage our acceptance of it, to turn our attention away from it, that suddenly we're going to drop all of that, just like that, as if it never was. That's the very essence of a continuity fear. That's the least likely thing to ever happen. It's only theoretically possible, but pragmatically you can say it's impossible. Pragmatically. And yet that is what we're told we're supposed to bank on. In other words, these cosmic crusaders tell, they're very clever, having long practice on this. And they say, hey, no, we're not trying to get rid of spiritual truth or anything like that. You know, in fact, we support that. And you can have a little bit here. That's okay, there's a little bit here, but not too much. We want to blend it in with other stuff, you know. And so what they do is, they say you can have spiritual teaching as long as you don't get familiar with it. Okay, this is what they bring. You know, this is their deal making cleverness that they have. And they're very clever. I would say they're relentlessly clever rather than really super clever, because not everything they do is transparent and obviously, you know, folly. But they're relentlessly that way, and that tends to make it seem as though they're being more clever than they really are. But they say, sure, no problem. Keep everything, your religions, this is the, but then to be fair to us, they say, you know, just don't get familiar, don't get familiar with it. Don't get familiar with it. Familiarity is the whole problem. I mean, that's the issue. The issue is familiarity. So the issue is not religious teaching, the issue is familiarity with teachings of truth. That's the issue. And they try to split that apart and say, no, the issue is religion and that's fine. And the familiarity is, well, that's fanatical, you can't have that. And they try and make it two separate things. No, religion actually serves familiarity, the whole process of getting familiar with truth. It's in the service of that. So you can't put it first and say, oh yeah, you have this, but not the familiarity. It's like one side of a coin and not the other. Those are two sides of one coin, religious truths and familiarity. Without the familiarity, this is not effective. It's not effective, and you stagnate, and you become dogmatic, and there's no success. So the cosmic crusaders foster a sense of sort of superficial righteousness, and everyone thinks, oh well, we live in a righteous society, all this stuff is, it's okay, we have a little bit there, a little bit there, and we're avoiding any excess or extremes, and we're balancing it out, and we're, you know, so we have a little bit of this. But what they're doing is avoiding familiarity with what they need to get familiar with, so it remains foreign to them. remains strange and weird and scary and disconcerting to them. It remains staggering to them. And of course, they have not practiced full stop in the now of the wow of clarification. So they're told that if something staggers them, upsets them, then that's wrong. Say, oh, I went too far. See, I went too far. Whoops. I need to back off. That's too far. Whereas in the religious, spiritual culture, you're supposed to go far enough so you're staggered, and then you let it settle down, and then you go further and let it settle down. So you welcome that as you get more and more familiar. That's the path. That's the path. So in this, the cosmic crusaders crushing out of truth on this planet, they're very clever. You know, Fabianism, creeping, 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 gradual, 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 never seeming to engage the issue at all, and yet undermining it the whole time. So they say, oh, you went too far. It was too much religious consideration because it upset you. We can't have anyone be upset. It's not upset. It's wowness. See, they mislabel it. It's like, wow, I see a way to get free of all this madness. Wow, this is great. But it's so wonderful. I don't even know where I am or what to say. I'm just over the moon with this. And they say, oh gosh, that's bad. That's bad. You can't. That means that you know what you're engaged with isn't right. It isn't right for you. And it sabotages the whole path. So I say the cosmic crusaders are saboteurs. There's no question about it. The beliefs, the practices that they're teaching everyone in the world supposedly become sophisticated, which is how they present it. That you're sophisticated, spiritually sophisticated. You know how not to overdo it, so you don't get this wow feeling. So they're teaching ersatz spiritual sophistication, what they're really doing is sabotaging the planet, sabotaging spiritual will on this planet. And this has been going on for quite some time. And it's about ready to reach its apex, actually. And you'll have this rollout, this collapsing, as it's called, a collective lapsing on this planet. There will be a certain point in time, as I've said, July of 2016, where there will be this collapse. Collapse means a collapsing. A lapse means to fall back into bad habits. And co means a joint effort, you know, among many. It will be a global collapse, okay? A collective lapsing back into this fake spiritual sophistication, which is actually a defense against truth, against continuity. The continuity fear is a defense against truth, a defense against the continuity fear. And that was essentially plunging the planet into darkness. And there'll be this great rollout of this collapsing, and then there'll be all this minefield of activism. There'll be this massive activism on the planet generated by this great collapse. And it all is the sense of like almost fanatic righteousness of, and we know, you know, now we know how to educate everybody. Now we have the answer. What they're really saying is, now we have the perfect defense against truth. So let's educate everybody, as if the perfect defense makes lies true. And they'll say, you know, now we know how to market lies correctly, as if the perfect way to market lies brings about perfection. But there is no perfect way to market lies, is there? Can't make market lies to make them true, cannot. But there will be this global activism from this collapsing, lapsing back into severe defensiveness, self-righteousness, fake enlightenment, all of this. Coming up very, very soon, coming up very, very soon. They think they find that everyone will say, oh, yeah, we know how to protect against this wow feeling. Yeah, we know how to cut it off before that ever can happen, you know. Whereas The spiritual path is to make sure that happens, is to foster that, foster it, foster it. Like, listen, listen, hear, hear, and like, wow, I just had a glimpse of that I'm free. You know, everyone's free. I was just sitting at the computer last night. I was so tired. Suddenly, I just had this moment where I saw everyone is free. And I can't even remember explaining exactly. It was very simple. And I just said, yeah, I see it. I recognize it now. I recognize the natural state of everyone, cosmically, just like that. You know, and I said, wow. Wow. You see, so that's the wow. You need to keep getting to all these breakthroughs and wows. Whereas the culture that's coming in the world is to avoid all of that, as if it were the worst plague possible, as if it was bad data that's going to contaminate their data, the good data, which means they won't get the answer of how to disempower God in order to save God from disempowerment. This is how the universe works. At least the universe that seems apparent to us. The universe of form, determinism, all this belief is a mirage, is a delusion. So I found that, what can you do? You cannot go directly to people and try to get them familiar, that they lapse back into talking points. Whatever those talking points may be. Because what they need to do is simply hear it and then see the wow. And then just quiet and just get used to this wow, wow. When I saw that everyone is inherently free, and I just, wow, okay, just quiet. No words, no thoughts, no concepts. Just feeling the impact of that is just like tremendous, wow. This is the path, this is the path. So you're not into talking points, however those talking points may be, whether they're simple, basic, you know, crude or sophisticated and polished or whatever, the whole gamut of talking points is you feel free of talking points. I had a dream last night. I was walking along, thinking I was walking from someplace, and then I realized I hadn't been in that place I thought I was walking from. And then I looked around and I said, wait a minute, I don't know where I am. I don't know where I am. I said, huh, that's interesting. Don't know where I am. Okay. An unusual experience. And Jesus tells us there is nowhere to where I am. So it's actually probably a very profound spiritual experience. It didn't really bother me that much. I found it very interesting. That's a wow. Like, wow. I have no idea. I have no idea where I am. I have no idea where I am. See, I am is not a concept or an idea of I know where I am, I'm here or something. It's I am is beyond even aware or even an everywhere. So I would say that virtually everyone I've met on this planet could certainly use an entire lifetime of getting used to familiar with spiritual teachings and truths. And maybe some will be able to do it in one lifetime. Maybe many can take more than one lifetime. But certainly everyone could greatly, greatly benefit from that. The benefit would be just immeasurable. And keep in mind that such a culture is very advanced and superior to what we have now. The absence of all the means of production that we have in this world, and all the gadgets and everything that we use to distract ourselves, and just a simple life, the absence of all that doesn't indicate primitiveness, just the opposite. It's a purposeful setting aside of that stuff, saying, oh, I'm too smart for that. You know, you're not going to fool me with that stuff. Keep it out. You see sometimes some kitchens that, you know, you see some kitchens that tools and the stove's got 8 burners and 2 ovens. And I mean, just the whole thing, you know, 2 double sink, I mean, sink in the island, a sink here, stove. I mean, it's just, you know, super sophisticated kitchens with everything in them. Double refrigerators, okay, you name it. And it's all stocked with the spices and the herbs. And, you know, you go in there and you say, oh my gosh, this is like, you know, heaven for cooking, right? And yet they can't cook. They can't cook very well at all. Now you get somebody who just has a little wood stove, or I mean, I just want to look at that, but just a simple burner, got one burner, 2 and gas stove, and hardly just 1 or 2 pans and just a few little instruments and everything. And yet they can cook up a dinner from simple ingredients and stuff, and you eat it and you say, wow, that just tastes great. That's a fabulous cooking. You know, the taste is great. And so it's like that. We need all the sophistication. It gets in the way. It gets in the way. So the genius of such a society and culture is it knows what to exclude, what to keep out. It knows what not to bring into a situation. Says, I will keep all that technology out, I will keep the science out, I will keep all that measurement out. We don't need all that stuff. It's like really good music. It's oftentimes what it leaves out. The genius is the notes that it leaves out, right? The break that it takes, the space that it gives the listener, that's the tastefulness. That's the tastefulness. So monastic culture is a very tasteful culture. Very sophisticated and tasteful culture. It knows what chit-chat to leave out, right? The distractions. Leaves the distractions out. That's not primitive. That's sophisticated. They're so sophisticated that they know all this so-called sophistication. They say, no, we don't need that. Been there, done that, we don't need that. You look at like the ancient monastic cultures, like in back in Buddhist times. You pay attention to how their minds were working, where their attention was working on back then, and you just say, "Wow, they're so sophisticated, spiritually sophisticated." We're like abject primitives to them. So we have this delusion that time is some sort of progression. It's time, what we think of time, is often a regression. Time is not some, you know, some force that is going, evolutionary force that is raising everything up, 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 up. It's often a severe regression. And just look at all the species that are going extinct right now in the world. How many over the last, you know, couple hundred years, whatever. Is that this great progression, or is that some severe regression? I would say we're severely regressed right now. We're in a phase of severe regression. And you don't snap your fingers with some savior and evaporate all that instantly. That's a pipe dream. That's a pipe dream. But also, I've not seen any, you know, progress towards really establishing the kind of culture that's needed here in this world. I thought coming in the 60s here, you know, in the 60s, 70s, and when the counterculture was, you know, at its height, that we were going to be able to turn the tide. Well, we did not turn the tide. because right on our heels came the Cosmic Crusaders and all their clever distractions for all the kiddies and all the babies and the big babies, you know. It's funny, everyone's focused on raising children, the babies, children is so important, you know. Well, who's raising the big babies? You know, the world's full of big babies, actually. And nobody's really taking care of their education and welfare and spiritual welfare at all. They're just cast adrift, really. But most people in the world are simply big babies, that's it. They don't have the familiarity with what really counts. So it's like a derelict culture right now. We want a ship of derelicts. And it's hard to captain, it's hard to pilot, you know, captain a ship of derelicts, you know, aboard. It's, you know, no, you can't get anyone, you know, the whole crew is just in the state of like total inebriated dereliction. How can you, you know, sail that ship? So we must remain all ears, as far as, you know, what is possible, for us. The kids now, they all have these tablets, and wherever they are, they slide down, they sit down, and they're, you know, playing these, you know, boom, 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 you know, shoot 'em up bombs, attack, and all these fear-based reaction games. Are these, you know, are all glamour games or whatever, clever manipulation games and all this clever stuff. This is what they're being raised on now constantly. A lot of them, or they're frantically doing their homework to try and get enough good grades to, so they get good enough jobs, they can make enough money, so they can survive in this place. But so, when a wow comes upon them, what do? The whole culture just overrides it. The whole culture, the caffeinated culture. The caffeinated Cosmic Crusader culture overrides the wow, overrides it. It says, yeah, we're out. Okay, great, come on, let's go. And put that into, you know, more energy, you know, come on, fight, let's get succeed. You know, we gotta get rid of the evil here. Instead of being taught, when the wow comes, recognize the wow, stop, full stop in the now of this wow. Make great efforts to stabilize your mind and your spirit, not by forcing stability, but like riding out the earthquake, the inner earthquake. Ride it out, the spiritual earthquake. It's not a physical earthquake, it's a spiritual earthquake. Ride it out and let it calm down and get used to it. And so you may feel like, you know what, I'm comfortable here. Try to get comfortable with this. So you sit quietly, full stop your mind in this. This is a great discipline. So this is the kind of discipline that needs to be taking place in culture, which means drop everything. You're eating lunch. Oh, wait a minute, I just had an epiphany. Wow. Stop. And your friends just go quiet too, you know. Said, chit-chat. Oh, really, tell us about it. What's it like? Oh, yeah, you know. He said, did you know that other person there? And I know, and blah, blah, Gaza, blah, 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 blah. Hey, can I have some more coffee and some more food cake? Okay, I'm ready to go. Let's go. Hey, I got stuff on my phone. Tweet. Instead, stop. Oh, epiphany. Yeah. All right. Shh. Don't say anything. It's like, don't say anything. Don't do anything. Just sit here. It's okay. We got your back. No problem. No hurry. No rush. Just sit here. We're not in a rush. In fact, this is a good opportunity for us to be quiet too. So this is actually normal. Okay, this is actually normal culture. What we have now in this world is completely bizarre culture. All right, at best you could call it utterly bizarre. The roads should have meditation pullouts where you can go off the road and there'll be like some you know some way to a place to sit, maybe a calm place there. And so you have you're driving, you have this epiphany, you can say, oh, let me just pull over and stop for a while. And when you have a whole culture that supports you doing that, then every day you'll find you have many breakthroughs every day, actually, which is what I have, many breakthroughs. Many of them profound breakthroughs every day, because I'm willing to stop, take the time, at least try to. It could certainly be better in a better culture, that's for sure. But instead they say, don't quit, you're being antisocial. Come on, stay up with the group. We're having fun here. No, I just want to... I need to, you know, I want to. So I found I had to isolate myself from people because they wanted you to just override, you know, the wow. And just, come on, you know, just turn your mind away from that. Don't think about that or whatever. I said, no, this is super important here. And now nobody got it, no one. Some gave lip service to it, you know, but as far as it actually, but there's a little bit of that in the 60s and 70s. There was a little bit of it. Yeah, there was talked about, and we were trying, saying, okay, just, you know, I need to center myself. Centering. Oh, okay. I'll take this time just to center and be comfortable with your space. Be in your space. Be centered in your space. Okay, it's fine, just, you know. So there was some of that crept in from monastic cultures like India, Tibet, and various places the traditions of medieval Christianity and various other traditions around the world. And there was some of that adapted by psychotherapists. So there was a little bit of a spiritual renaissance in the 60s and the 70s before the curtain came crashing down. Cosmic Crusader curtain of really big business on a cosmic scale. Wanting to figure, you know, cull data from everyone and figure it out. How can we market disempowerment so it actually is disempowerment? It's like taking a picture of a glass of water. How can we take a photograph of water so that photograph actually is water? You know, this is a way of putting it. And so we're all got these, you know, different cameras, and we're just lighting on the water. You know, we're all taking pictures of this water. And we're fanatically into photographing this water. And we're all trying to, so we say, if we just all keep working at this, eventually the photograph will be the water. It will be the water. And the image will be the water, right? The image of the water will be the water. If we just get the right picture, the right image, it will no longer be an image. It will be the water. It's just like that, actually. It's just that stupid. So, the Cosmic Crusaders are here to get all the data they can about imaging, because we're imaging here, taking images, marketing to imagery, using imagery to market. Okay, what kind of responses do we get from this imagery, from this imagery, and this approach? Music's a type of imagery, actually. And so, then collecting all the data, feeding it into centralized computers and more centralized computers and more centralized, trying to determine, okay, you know, what is the right, what is the secret, what is the approach for an image to be real, for a symbol to be what it symbolizes. This is the folly of existence. So they're here with all their tools to measure, all the subtle, sophisticated measuring capabilities and collect data collection capabilities. And we're told if we don't want to participate, no, come on, you could be the one. You know, they like, so you could be the one that finally solves the problem. You don't know. Everybody has to try. We don't know who we hold. We said we don't know who holds the secret within them. It could be you. It could be anybody. So everybody has to participate because we don't know who it is. In fact, they say nobody knows who it is, but somewhere someone has the answer. And we'll only find it if everybody participates. This is their belief system. So you say, I don't want to participate. To them, that's like blasphemy. He says, no, it's completely unacceptable. Everybody has to participate in this. How do we disempower ourselves? Sweepstakes. You might have the winning number. You don't know. And I say, nobody has the winning number. And it's like, but that's going to cause the disempowerment of God. That's horrible. That's blasphemous. God hates you. You're going to be thrown into a pit of fire and burn forever in hell and then be annihilated. And then, you know, this is the madness of it. Again, what is the basic false premise? That if we don't find a way to disempower God, God will be disempowered by that failure. So if we say, no, I don't want to participate because there's no way to disempower God, then they'll say, oh my God, you're the one who's going to cause, you're going to cause them the failure, disempowerment of God, because we're going to fail, you know. God's going to hate you for that. You will fundamentally, it means you want to disempower God, so God hates you because of that. You're a sinner, and God hates you. So we can track back the madness into this very simple premise of, we say we must find a way to disempower God. This is our mission. This is what has to be done. Otherwise, if we don't, God is going to be disempowered. And so if you don't participate in this attempt to find disempowerment, you're really desiring to disempower God. And then God must then therefore must hate you, and you must deserve eternal damnation. Now, if we put it this way, it's all seems silly, right? It is silly. This is actually how it is. We just try to frantically rationalize it all, make it serious. It's not serious at all. This rain is trying to get serious, but it can't. It just, for some reason, it just can't get serious yet. Now, keep in mind that the purpose of these videos is to bring up this wow, and that we need to full stop in this wow, and that's the discipline. So it's very serious content here. Bringing silliness to light is a very serious endeavor, because if we don't bring it to light, if we forget to laugh at it, then we will take it seriously. So taking silliness seriously is a very serious mistake. So we must be seriously intent upon not taking silliness seriously. So wash your car and it rains. Complain that it's not raining hard enough, and suddenly it starts raining hard. Wonderful. And you should know how to bust the drought then in California. Let's let everybody wash their cars the same day. Now, here's a good analogy with the problem of familiarity and the drought in California. It's very simple. It's raining now, right? It means, you know, just lightly raining. And people in California say, wow, you know, maybe the drought's over. Okay, I just read an article that actually in some areas of the Central Valley, they're going down, I thought it was 300 feet someplace, but someplace 3,000 feet to get water. They're going down 3,000 feet to get water now. Now, how long does it take for water that falls upon the land to percolate down 3,000 feet and start filling up? It has to go down that far, and so it starts filling up this reservoir, right? Anyway, there's various ways to measure that and talk about it, but basic fact is, water percolates down into the underground aquifers quite slowly actually. So it could take years before the water even gets down there and becomes more available to us. So that's why droughts are not broken quickly. It takes a while. It takes several years, even if we get a good rain. Good rainfall total, the drought is not over. So in familiarity, even if we start talking about spiritual truths and teachings, it takes a while to really percolate down. It takes quite a while. That's why I say a lifetime is an important investment. Invest a lifetime in familiarity. Where it really, really percolates down through you, because we've been in this drought, a spiritual drought. We're in a spiritual drought in this world. Very bad drought. It's not going to be, it's not like if suddenly tonight we get 24 inches of rain in some monsoon. That's not going to cure the problem at all. Most of that's going to run off anyway. It takes time for it to soak in. Same thing with spiritual talk and familiarity. It takes time for it to soak in. It really does. And we get frustrated because we say, wow, it's been raining. I've been working on this for so long, and still I feel like it hasn't quite soaked in. Well, it takes a long time for it to sink in because we've been so parched. So it takes a while to spiritually hydrate ourselves again. Which is why we need a basic monastic culture, religious, spiritual, theocratic monastic culture, so that everyone realizes, hey, I can spend a lifetime at this, and they keep working on it. That'll help. That'll be a drought buster. That's a drought buster. See, the temperature's cooled off enough, I guess, now that the rain is starting to come down more heavily. That's quite a symphony of sound there. Keep in mind that the sound we're hearing that's localized close to you by here, actually, there's the same type of sound going on all over the entire area, the whole neighborhood, everywhere, right? So it must be producing some sort of, like, white noise type of thing. It has to, right? Because you listen how noisy it is here. This isn't the only place that is noisy. Wherever there's bushes and shrubs and wherever, this rain is making all sorts of drip, drop, everywhere. And that's all reverberating into the atmosphere. So again, keep in mind that this information does strain us. It absolutely strains us. I'm feeling pretty tired right now from it. But we do bounce back from it if we can maintain our patience. That's the tricky part. Is simply maintain your patience until you feel you catch a second wind. And know that you will catch a second wind. But sometimes we have a tendency to despair and say, wow, I thought that this solved the spiritual drought. I thought it's over, and yet it's not over. Well, it has to sink in. So just like we have to maintain our disciplines here in California with the usage of water, just because we got rain, we don't abandon them. Same thing with the spiritual path. Just because we get breakthroughs, don't abandon your discipline. Continuity fear is still there. So realize the troubles that you're feeling is because of the continuity fear. That's it. It's not because anything you're thinking or not thinking. So don't struggle with your thoughts at all. Don't just be patient. Be quiet and be patient. Oftentimes we forget what we even talked about. So then we have a tendency to think, oh, maybe I didn't really make any progress at all. What happens is you're in a state of shock, a staggered mindness. Wow. And so you forget what caused that, but because you're so in it, you know, you're in shock. So don't make the mistake of thinking, oh, wait a minute, maybe I didn't really do anything important at all. Maybe, you know, maybe this is the state is needing for more push further. No, it's that it's already reached a point where it's shock. Let the shock, the spiritual shock, wear off. And then your clarity will return. It'll be even stronger than before. It's like practicing a guitar, for instance. You can practice, and you start reaching diminishing returns. And then you think, wow, I've not been making any progress at all. This is horrible. And you try to keep pushing yourself, and it gets worse, and you lose your sense of creativity. You say, I'm terrible. I'm not getting any progress at all. And then what happens? Then you like may wait, skip a day or something, or a couple hours, but let's just use a day or two, or sometimes I skip a week and practice for 3 weeks straight, and at the end of the 3 weeks you feel just like, I can hardly play at all, it's terrible. Skip a week and then come back, and how good do you sound then? Then you just say, oh my gosh, I'm way better than I used to be. This is amazing. Then you practice a whole bunch more, and before you, you know, after a while, you don't sound so good anymore. This is the frustrating thing for musicians, which is why they often take drugs. Drugs and music go hand in hand for sure, because it's very frustrating. Music is very frustrating. I find the spiritual path is less frustrating, more rewarding than music. Music can just drive you nuts. Because the difference between sounding good and satisfying and not is a very fine line. It's like a razor. The difference between a good shave and a painful shave is just a fine, you know, the fine line, that sharpness, that ultra sharpness. Just lose that ultra sharpness and it doesn't feel right. So when you're ultra, ultra sharp musically, then you feel like, wow, I'm a true musician. This is amazing what I'm doing. This is fantastic. I love it. I'm so creative. But, and then you don't want to stop, right? And so you play more and more and more. Eventually you get tired, you get worn down, and all the feedback of it all, it all starts feeling flat to you. And then you say, oh, what happened to my, what happened? It's gone. It's horrible. I lost it. I can't, how do I get it back? I don't know. How do I lose it? This is terrible. And then, if you try to go back to it, I gotta get this back. I gotta get this, that feeling back again. And you can't do it. And then someone says, the snake comes along and says, hey, buddy, you know, I got something that can help you. Try this out. Take a little bit of this stuff. See what you think then. Wow, my creativity is so enhanced, you know, that's so amazing. This is great. I really am the great musician I thought I was. But that goes flat too. And then you take a little bit more, and then that doesn't work anymore. And then someone will say, buddy, I got some new stuff, let's see, that different stuff, but this, try this. Take that, you know. And that goes on and on and on and on. Musicians are absolute suckers for drugs. Absolute suckers. Oftentimes when you drop the musicianship, you drop the drugs too. Don't need them anymore. But I found that most musicians use substances of some kind or another. Most. I'd say very, very high percentage. Certainly in certain fields. But the same way with singing. I mean, anything using the body like this, you could practice singing. You know, just tremendous amount of practice. You think, wow. But then you just feel like you just don't have it. You don't have it. Give it some time. Don't do anything. Come back and you feel fresh and try again and pow. You just say, wow, this is amazing. How can I sing that well? I don't know. And then it wears down again and it's gone again. It's very elusive. You cannot just summon it like that. You can't summon that edge of performance. You cannot. Which is why musicians, again, especially professionals, where they're supposed to summon it on demand for their audiences, for their, you know, for their managers, for their accountants, and all this stuff, record labels, et cetera, et cetera. A lot of people are depending on them to summon it at will. Got to be on point every performance. They take drugs. They go to drugs. They may feel like they don't have it at all that day. Like in this taping, most of the times I feel like I don't have it at all. So this is going to be terrible. But I just say, you know what? I'm going to warm up, see if I can get into it, and do the very best I can. In a spiritualized, monastic, religious, theocratic, contemplative culture, people would understand this. You know, it would be supportive. So you don't need to take drugs. That's okay. Your clarity may flatten out. That's called the continuity fear and the staggered mindness. Let it settle down. virtuosos are always obsessed about that edge and how to get it. And they're always, you know, very nervous and neurotic about it. Like the divas, you know, the great singers and the divas. They're so neurotic. Rosa Ponselle quit singing because it's driving her crazy. So that's it. I'm going to be a basket case if I don't stop. Because, you know, how do you keep that edge? How do you keep that edge? One of the greatest singers ever been on this planet just flat out quit singing. Young, well, pretty young still. Just smart. That's it. I'm finished. This is gonna drive me nuts. The managers of the Southern Mafia that controlled George Jones, another one of the greatest singers that ever on this planet. They got him hooked on cocaine, right? And they were just his suppliers. And then they put him out there night after night after night, as many shows as possible, and kept him in a, you know, severely drugged up state so that he felt all, you know, capable of singing really well, and just milking him for money. And he was so in such bad condition, they literally had to use this tape his body and his torso and everything so he wouldn't fall down on stage. Beneath his clothes, he was all taped up. Tape. Taping the knees, taping the... I mean, they managed to keep him so he could stand up there and he wouldn't fall down. And so he could sing and they could make money. And they kept him addicted to cocaine. And he tried to escape them many times. They tried to track him down. In fact, they got all the local police searching for him. You know, like, they say, he's in danger. We're worried about him. So they got all the good old boys in there, you know, going back in the back mountains searching for George Jones. And he was back there, and like, driving his hopped-up car, which he had many cars. He got new cars all the time. And he'd be driving the back roads of the Piney Mountains, who knows, and trying to hide from the Southern Mafia, trying to track him down. Because he was their meal ticket. He was their meal ticket. So it was brutal. Absolutely brutal. Finally, I had to end up in a mental institution to dry out. And they couldn't get to him there. They couldn't get to him. That's the edge, you see. And so, you have to be very guarded against this problem. Very carefully. So when you get this, the wow, full stop in the wow, performance over, you know, like that. No performance required. And put all your will into stabilizing. So monastic culture is not a performance-based culture. It is not a performance-based culture, okay? It's very important. Also, musicians are suckers for instruments because they lose the edge and they feel the edge. And they say, wow, I need to buy a new guitar, for instance. That will give it back to me. So they go into the guitar shop and there's like hundreds of guitars, vintage, every kind is so wonderful. And you say, oh, I'm going to try that one. So they hook you up with some really, really deluxe amp they have in there. This sounds great. They got a tweak just right. And you're in there and you start playing. It's like, whoa, I feel really creative. There's this buzz, you know. And you think, yeah, I gotta get this, I have to get this. If I get this, I'll never have this, you know, lapse again. I'll always have this creative edge. And so you get that. And they're, you know, complete suckers for that, for gear. Everybody who's in, you know, gear, getting into more and more gear is materialistic culture. This is what happens. Everybody becomes gear freaks. Drug freaks, gear freaks, looking for that. Where's that creative edge? That what happened to it? Rise to the surface. I guess It just gave rise to a severe continuity fear through seeing the good news. That's great. Okay. This is the edge. This is the edge. So just full stop in the wow. This, the now, this wow. Full stop. Now, in this performance-based culture we have, it's on demand, the edge on demand. Whereas the wiser musicians, for instance, know that, hey, I don't have it today, but if I warm up a lot and get into it, and, you know, I'll be able to find it in some way. But it takes time, and the audience has to be patient also. But in this very demanding world we live in now of instant gratification, you're supposed to be on point, this summit it on instant. That again is why they get, you know, people get into drugs and all sorts of ways they try to, you know, have it on demand. Everybody expects you to be on point, on demand. But this leaves no room for the wowness, does it? It leaves no room for it. The culture leaves no room for it whatsoever. And if I try, imagine I try to tell us, go around and tell people, this blank, this, they'll just lapse into talking points almost instantly. Or there's no more communication. It's just hurling talking points at me. Not only that, they insist that you agree with their talking points, you know. They win. You gotta win. They say, no, we gotta win. We cannot have a performance-based culture at all. Cannot. And it may seem to performance-based cultures, may seem we're getting nowhere. They look at us backwards. Dark ages, backwards, won't get anywhere. What are they doing? Wasting their time. No. They're getting familiar with truth. They're evaporating the continuity fear, bit by bit. They're getting used to the good news. You might say that the whole purpose of it all is getting used to the good news. Get used to the good news. Get used to the good news. So I'm doing what I can, little what I can here in this world now. But the receptivity is meager in this world, isn't it? It's a time of meagerness. And it takes time. It takes time. And this world is not willing to give it time. See? Not willing at all. No, change, faster pace, more predictive productivity. We want to be on point right in this instant, right now. We want to, what continuity fear they say. We'll just, you know, blast it away somehow. So we're getting into a very blasty culture, I would say. A very blasty culture, right? And this is something, of course, over the last 20 years, let's say, 20 years, we've noticed we've gotten into extremely blasty culture. I mean, almost every day there's some, you know, some massive explosion somewhere, killing many, many people. Wars, you know, the various wars that have broken out, massive blasts all over. The world has gotten super blasty, super blasty. Thinking they can blast the continuity fear away. They can blast the resistance to disempowerment away. And so the more we go to the secular materialism of we don't have any time for the continuity fear to settle down to full stop in the now. We don't have any time for that on demand, right this instant. That's very blasty. You want to blast through it. You want to blast through it. It shows up as a blastiness, consciousness, a blasty consciousness in the world. And all these blasts have been taking place. It's a function of consciousness that's taking place. You see, a monastic culture doesn't have any blastiness in it. You don't have all this terrorism and stuff in monastic culture. Because people say, take time. You don't need to blast through the continuity fear. Let it just evaporate organic. Let it evaporate. If you need to spend an hour or two sitting quietly, that's what you're supposed to do. Great. We're not on any, you know, blasty schedule. So, very peaceful. Consciousness, very peaceful. Very forgiving, very kind, very peaceful. Very non-blasty, very non-blasty. So of course it would be a much more peaceful situation, that sort of culture, infinitely so. So the good news is very triggerable. That's what the purpose of teachers are for: encourage, inspire, and trigger the good news. Trigger and so the triggering the wow of the good news, the glimpse of it. Jesus calls it the holy instant. Get a glimpse of the holy instant. Just for an instant. And he says it saves you thousands of years. Just one glimpse of the holy instant saves you thousands of years of delay. Thousands. And then you see it and you realize, wow, I just saved myself thousands of years. You just realize, I just saved myself thousands of years of suffering by just what I just did. Wow. But how could you avoid the wow from that? And this is organic. This is why the path is so potent, is you see, and you're very clear, and you realize that you just saved yourself enormous suffering by just that glimpse. And how could you not feel wow about that? You have to. It's completely profound. And you want to sit there, and you just let it shaking almost with this incredible good fortune that you just had, that you just liberate yourself from a massive amount of suffering. So how do you process that? See, yeah, that has to be processed somehow. You have to accept it. You have to realize it just happened. It already happened. It's too late. You can't stop it. It just happened. This is the thing. You have these epiphanies, these breakthroughs, this holy instant glimpses, and this saves you thousands of years of suffering, and even more at times. It's already happened. It's fait accompli, this just happened. So you can't help but react to that as a wow. How did that happen? This leaf just somehow just came down and landed on my arm. From where? That was quite amazing. Maybe it's time to leave. Time to leave this planet, maybe. These people into knuckleheadedness here, into very blastiness, great blastiness, into collapsing. Lapsing back into trying to disempower themselves instead of get familiar with the fact we can't. This is a collapse. So we don't want to hang around with this massive collapse, do we? No, we don't. Because we could end up collapsing along with them, for sure, being how contagious it is, being that minds are all one, and so these kind of things can be very contagious. Because the go-go-go-ness, the blasty of the culture, just gets into all of us, right? It's very tough to drive here in the Silicon Valley and not get caught up in that syndrome. Very tough. I try not to. I do a pretty good job of it. Jeez, I almost got in an accident today. And this GPS saying, you know, turn here, drive forward, turn here. So I'm following the GPS, listening to it. I said, okay, I'll take its route. It gave me a different route. I said, okay, let me see how it works. I'll take this route. Maybe this is more of a quicker route. It's probably about even, but okay, fine. So I get up to this intersection. It says, turn right, here, turn right. And so I start turning right, okay? And then suddenly I saw a car on my left, and it's not slowing down. I said, oh, wait a minute. And I stopped, and I looked, and the light was red, you know. So I was paying more attention to just turn right, than I was looking at the traffic light, you see. I said, whoa, just narrowly missed an accident. I almost turned right into the front of this traffic that was coming, because you get used to following the instructions of the GPS. When it says turn, tells you to turn right, it should say turn right when safe. You know, it should, they should modify GPSs to say turn right when safe, or something like that, or when safe, turn right. It is very important, because I almost fell into that trap. In fact, I did. For it was just a blessing I didn't have an accident, a bad accident. Another half second, I would have. I just said, wait a minute, something's not right. How come that car is going right through the intersection? It doesn't make any sense. And then I realized I'd forgotten to look at the traffic light. It was red. Or I may have looked at it, but then when it turned right, I just started, you know, obeying the instruction. And so we may be in a world where we end up obeying instructions at some point, right, that are not the right instructions. Very possible. So right there, you see, I almost fell victim to technology right there. When safe, turn right. If traffic, when safe, turn right, or turn right when safe, turn right when safe. And so then you'll check to see if it's safe. So turn right when safe. Okay, let me see. Oh, traffic lights red. Now they don't say that. You turn right here, turn right. So it's very insistent. And of course, it's always got this, you know, it's always the mother's voice on these GPSs, right? So you tend to just like obey them like a child almost. Like, okay, mom, sure, I'll turn right. It's designed to get you to be more compliant, actually. And to agree with what the, you know, the these gadgets are telling you to do, and become very, very used to that. You know, it's like these voice, you know, smartphones. Hey, so and so, you know, where can I go to a restaurant? What should I do? Ask questions. You know, we're supposed to be getting, they're supposed to be getting the answers in life from this mother-like voice telling you, oh yeah, this is what. Oh, thank you. Yeah, okay. It's all prepping people for this collapse. That was quite scary. I could hardly believe I did that. Wow, I fell under the spell of technology there for a moment. It's better to drive without the GPS, that's for sure. Especially if you know the route, forget it. Turn it off. Voice command. Stop route. Voice command, stop route. Quiet. You know, that's the way to go. So we may have all these voices, these commands programmed into us saying, do this, turn right. We need to just say, hey, voice command, stop route. Quiet, go monastic. Go monastic. So we can say, hey, wait, I know the way home. I don't need to be following this, all these commands, you know. Just sit quietly. The quickest way home is just to sit quietly. And the more you do that, the more you're able to handle the good news. You see a lot of people in a monastic, religious, theological culture, theocratic culture, place of worship culture, sitting quietly. So they can absorb the good news. Absorbing the good news staggers our familiarity. Absorbing the good news staggers our familiarity. We're not familiar with it, plain and simple. So sitting quietly is one of the best shock absorbers there is. Maybe the best. Can't beat it. Throughout history, that's what many have done. It's a shock absorber. And our contemporary modern culture is the opposite of that. It says, keep going. Go faster, be more productive. Don't let those kind of things interfere with your productivity. Inadvisable, do not stop. Keep your productivity going. got all these all this in our minds, right? All these voices, commands, demands, all this collective pressure, demands of this. Keep going, do not stop. You must succeed. You must succeed at what? You must succeed at disempowering God. Disempowering ourselves through these bodies. These bodies symbolize disempowerment. It's just a symbol. It symbolizes disempowerment. That's what Jesus said. Look, you kill the body, I'll raise it up again. It's just a symbol you're using to of disempowerment, but it doesn't actually disempower spirit at all. And they said, no, you're a liar, Jesus. He said, okay, we'll put it to the test. We'll find out who's a liar. Find out who's lying, who's telling the truth. He's alive, he's alive. No death can be fine, you know. So he's resurrected from death. Okay, so who told the truth and who lied? Very simple. And we're still trying to sort it out. These bodies are just symbolic ways of trying to symbolize disempowerment. Just how we try to symbolize disempowerment of spirit. Which spirit cannot be disempowered. And then we say, oh, wait, uh-oh, that means God's going to be disempowered. No, it doesn't mean that at all. This is just a whimsical formula that we've, you know, brought to the table to try to motivate us. Disempowerment is a non-starter from the very beginning. It's a non-starter from the very beginning. That's why Jesus said the Satan is a liar from the very beginning, or the devil, whatever, the ego. In other words, to even entertain this idea of disempowerment, we have to lie from the very beginning, because it's a complete non-starter from the very beginning. So in order to make it seem like a starter, we say, well, we have to disempower ourselves, otherwise God will be disempowered. So it becomes a crusade immediately. The universe is this crusade, instant crusade, in order to entertain this idea of trying to be greater than God. So we all have this problem with familiarity. It only yields gradually. That is true. If I put in like, and my dog Spot in the video, you know, and most people, after watching this whole video, well, what they'll remember is, oh yeah, and my dog Spot. He said he had a dog Spot. That's what they will remember, right? The rest of the stuff is foggy. I can't quite remember what it was. But so that shows you that you know, it sinks in gradually, but you have to keep working at it as much as possible. It takes a while to end the drought. So that's why I keep repeating and over and over and over and over and over, repeating various in various ways. So it gradually sinks in. But if you really want to remember something, you have to actually work at it. Really, find some way to attach yourself to it. Bind yourself to truth. But again, you have to become comfortable enough so you don't lapse into level confusion. Otherwise, you can't really use words at all. Or if you try to skirt level confusion, the whole thing becomes a ridiculous circus of attenuated, you know, massive attenuation of compound words, sentences. It just all becomes a jumble, you know. It becomes performance art. So the more you get a comfort zone, the more you just brush aside this level of confusion. You know, you say, well, you need to bind yourself to freedom. Well, how can I be free? Blah, 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 blah. That's level of confusion, of course. We understand that we're speaking on the pragmatic level. So the more we bind ourselves to the realization that freedom is